Hi guys, in this lesson we're going to look at the various protection and encryption options for our data that's on Amazon S3, Amazon EBS, and the Elastic File System. So let's start off with S3. Now we have a few different options for encryption. The first one is known as server-side encryption with S3 managed keys, also known as SSE-S3. This uses S3 managed keys, unique object keys, a master key, and AES-256 encryption. The encryption and decryption takes place on S3 itself. So if you have your customer here or your client actually connecting to an S3 bucket, the encryption process is taking place on the S3 side. We then have server-side encryption with AWS KMS managed keys, that's known as SSE KMS. This uses KMS managed keys, and the KMS key can be customer generated as well. Now again, the encryption and decryption is happening on the S3 side. It's happening in the bucket, or as your data is written to the bucket and read back from the bucket. You then have server-side encryption with client-provided keys. This is SSE-C. In this case, again, the encryption and decryption is happening on the bucket, so it's happening on the S3 side. But you can use client-managed keys here. They're not stored on AWS. So you have your own keys, but the encryption and decryption process is taking place on the AWS side. So this is a key difference with client-side encryption. So client-side encryption can be confused quite easily with server-side encryption with client-provided keys, but of course the encryption is actually taking place on the client side, not on the server side. That's the key difference. But there is a small clarification which you need to understand. So the encryption-decryption is taking place on the customer side here. So this could be an application in your own data center that's encrypting and decrypting data. Nothing is happening from an encryption perspective on S3. The data just gets stored there in an encrypted state. If you're encrypting it here, you read it back, it comes back over the internet as encrypted data, and then your application would decrypt it. But the clarification is that you can use a KMS key. So the key that you're using it here, you're not using it in KMS, but it can be a data encryption key from KMS. So make sure you remember that. But don't confuse server-side encryption and client-side encryption. Firstly, the encryption is taking place with server-side in AWS. With client-side, it's always going to happen on the client-side in your application outside of AWS. Or it could be in AWS. It could be running on EC2, for example. But you can use either your own keys, they're not stored on AWS, or you can use a KMS key as well. You can configure default encryption for your S3 buckets, and that means that the specific behavior you choose will take place. So if you configure encryption on your bucket by default, then all new objects that are uploaded to that bucket will be encrypted. The objects are encrypted using server-side encryption, and S3 will encrypt the objects before saving them to disk, and then it decrypts them before they are actually downloaded. There's no change to the encryption status of objects that existed in the bucket before you enabled default encryption. Now, enabling default encryption doesn't force encryption, okay? So it's the default behavior, but it's all about the headers in your put request. So if you're putting data into S3, you can add a header there that says that you want to use a certain encryption algorithm, or you can specify that you don't want to use encryption. So you can actually control through your put request the encryption status. Now we might want to prevent that. We might want to force the encryption to use a specific protocol like AES-256, or we might just want to make sure that no objects are uploaded unless they're encrypted. So this policy here will enforce encryption using SSE-S3. And for SSE-KMS, you would use AWS:KMS instead of AES-256. So now, if you perform a put request, you must have the header XAMZ server-side encryption set to AES-256. If that's not set correctly, or if it's set, for instance, with this policy to KMS because you wanted to try and put your object using KMS encryption, it's not going to allow that put request because it doesn't match what you're specifying in the bucket policy. Glacier Vault Lock and Vault Access policies are something you need to understand. So Glacier is for archiving your data, and Vault Lock enforces compliance controls for Glacier with a Vault Lock policy. You can use controls such as write once, read many in a Vault Lock policy. So you can lock the vault from any kind of future edits. So you can ensure that your data has not been modified. Once locked, the policy can no longer be changed. We then have the Vault Access policy. This is a resource-based policy that you can use to manage permissions to your vault. You can create one Vault Access policy for each vault to manage your permissions, and you can modify the permissions in a Vault Access policy anytime. You use these with the Vault Lock, so you've got the Access policy and then the actual Lock policy as well. Now let's move on to Amazon EBS encryption. So EBS is the Elastic Block Store, and these are the volumes that you attach to your EC2 instances. These are accessed over the network, in contrast to instance store volumes, which are actually local within the server that hosts your EC2 instance. However, they are both block-based volumes. Now, you can encrypt your EBS volume, and the data is encrypted both in transit between your instance and the volume, and at rest on the EBS volume itself. If you create a snapshot from an EBS volume, the snapshot will also be encrypted. Traffic between instances is also encrypted in transit for some instance types. Now, if traffic is moved between an AZ between instances, that is also encrypted. Now, EBS encryption of your volumes will affect the data at rest inside the volume, all data moving between the volume and the instance, and all snapshots created from the volume. And all volumes created from those snapshots will also be encrypted. If you copy a volume, however, you can change the encryption status. So let's have a look at the different options for copying and sharing Amazon Machine images and snapshots. So first, we have a volume and we create a snapshot. The encryption status is retained and it will be in the same region. If we take a snapshot and encrypt that snapshot, so this is a copy process, that's how we can change the encryption status of a snapshot. And you can also change the region. We can also take an unencrypted snapshot and create an encrypted volume. When we do that, we can also change the availability zone. You can also take an unencrypted snapshot and create an AMI. Now, you can't encrypt the AMI. You'd have to first copy the snapshot, create an encrypted snapshot, and then create an AMI. It can be shared with other accounts, and it can also be shared publicly. You can take a snapshot and copy it to another snapshot, both change the encryption key and change regions. Another thing you can do is take an encrypted snapshot and create an encrypted AMI. In this case, the AMI can be shared with other accounts, but only if you're using a custom KMS key. And you must specify the decrypt and create grant permissions on the KMS key. Now, in this case, the encrypted AMI cannot be shared publicly. You can also take an encrypted AMI, copy it to another encrypted AMI, and in the process, change the encryption key that's used and change the region. So if you use the default encryption key and you want to share the AMI with another account, this is a good opportunity to change the encryption key and then share it. You can take an encrypted AMI, create an EC2 instance, and while doing so, you can change the encryption key and the availability zone. You can take an unencrypted AMI, create an EC2 instance, change the encryption state, and the AZ. And lastly, you can take an encrypted snapshot, create an encrypted volume, and this can be encrypted and you can change the AZ. So there's a lot of different options there. It's quite a lot to remember, but if you actually use EC2 a lot and EBS and you're creating AMIs and you're copying them to different regions and all the different things that you can do, you'll soon get a grasp of what you can and cannot do. Moving on to EFS encryption, the Elastic File System. So EFS file systems are mounted using the NFS protocol, and you can mount many instances to a file system across VPCs and across availability zones. You can mount file systems from on-premises servers over a Direct Connect connection or a VPN as well. So we have a VPC here with an Elastic file system. This one is encrypted at rest, and that's something that you can enable when the file system is created only. so you can't do it later on. Remember that. Our EC2 instances are then going to mount that file system. And these will be Linux instances. Only Linux is supported for EFS. Now, when those instances mount the file system, you can specify encryption in transit for TLS encryption over the network.